Hey everyone, it's Lisa from the blog farmhouseonboone.com, and today I want to answer some of the most frequently asked questions about caring for and maintaining a sourdough starter. So I would say that the most common question I get asked on my blog, Instagram, YouTube, email, everywhere, has to do with sourdough starter. It's a really simple concept, but until you get used to it, there's definitely a lot of variables that can make you wonder if you're even doing it right. So if you're completely brand new to sourdough starter, which I doubt that you are if you're on this video, but if you are, I do have a video all about making your own sourdough starter from scratch, and how to maintain it and all of that. I'll leave a link for that original video below so that you can check it out. First, I'm just gonna answer some of the questions I get all the time, and then I'm gonna pop over to Instagram where I put out one of those question bars in my stories to get some more questions from people so that I can make sure that I get all the questions you all have. Okay, one question I get asked all the time is right at the very beginning when you're starting to make your starter. Now in the original instructions, I have a water and a flour ratio. That's just to give you a guideline, but it totally depends on what kind of flour you're using. If you're using an all-purpose, you can usually get away with a little bit less water, or if you're using like whole grain wheat. If it feels way too doughy and not like it can stir, I always tell people just go ahead and add a little bit more filtered water. Another question I get is about the discarding half. A lot of times people wonder if when they discard half, if they can just create another sourdough starter. Okay, so that doesn't actually make sense, because what you're creating is basically a symbiotic colony of yeast that you capture from your local environment. So what you're trying to do is just create a master starter that then can inoculate anything else with the yeast colonies that are in it. So you do not need to create more than one. That's basically just like having more starter, which once you have an established starter, you can easily do by just adding more flour and water. So that's a little bit challenging to explain, but basically what I'm saying is all that you're throwing away when you discard starter is flour and water. Just think of it that way. There's really no way else to do it, because what you have is an immature starter at that point. And there's really not a ton that you can do with it, especially if you're making a sourdough starter because you can't really tolerate grains. What you have there is not fully fermented yet. So if you're trying to avoid grains that are unfermented, you're just going to want to discard it. Now you could put it in your compost, maybe you could feed it to your animals. It's not like you're throwing away perfectly good sourdough starter, and to create another one is just more of the same. I hope that makes sense. It's kind of difficult to explain. Okay, another question I get asked all the time is how I store my starter. When you're feeding your starter, you leave it out on the counter where it can get a little bit of air. So you might put like a tea towel or something not airtight. But when it goes in the refrigerator, you are going to want to use something airtight. Me personally, I keep my starter in a glass bowl. This is a 2.5 quart bowl, and I cover it with a silicone lid. This is what I've always done. Now on occasion, I have to empty the starter out, clean the bowl really well because things get really crusty up here on the top and you don't want that, but then put it right back in, and then I always just keep my master starter in here. Now I like to keep a pretty good amount because there are certain no weight recipes that you can make, like my sourdough skillet and my sourdough pancakes. And if you have enough in here that you can pull from, you can always make those without having to wait, as long as the starter is fed and full. Now you always wanna leave some in there that you can feed again and continue on with your starter. But as long as you can remove quite a bit while still leaving about a cup or a half cup in there, you can feed it and get it back to a full bowl of starter. Okay, another question I get all the time is how often do you feed your starter? So this totally depends on how much you want to use it. If you're gonna be using your starter daily, say you wanna make pancakes every morning or English muffins on occasion and then some bread sometimes, you can leave it out on your counter and you can just feed it every single day. Now we don't use ours daily, I'll use mine about once a week. So what I'll do is I will keep it in the refrigerator with this airtight lid, and then say that it's Friday and I wanna make pancakes on Saturday. I'll pull my starter out of the refrigerator, add a little bit of flour water, stir it around, cover it with a tea towel, and then leave it out on the counter until Saturday when I wanna make pancakes. Now let's say that I'm done, I'm not gonna make pancakes again until next Saturday. I can go ahead and cover it and put it back in the fridge. Or let's say that on Sunday I wanna make cinnamon rolls. I will leave it on my counter and just give it some more flour and water. And being in that room temperature, the yeast will again be nice and active and it'll become bubbly sourdough starter. When you put it in the refrigerator, it kind of puts it on pause. So you don't have to feed it as often because the yeast are all very relaxed and they don't need a whole bunch of sustenance. Kind of think of it like a bear hibernating in the winter. They don't need a whole lot, but whenever they're active, they need a ton. And so when it's out on the counter, you need to feed it daily. But when it's in the fridge, you can just feed it once a week. You can go back and forth. So I might use my starter 3 or 4 days in a row and then put it in the fridge for 2 weeks. You can even do that. 1 week's good, but you can definitely get away with once every 2 weeks. So it totally depends on how often you want to use it. They're very, very resilient. I've had this starter for 8 years now, still doing great. Bubbly, active, can make all the things I want it to. I never measure, so that's another question I get all the time is how much water and flour to feed it. I totally do not measure. I just add it until it's about the consistency of maybe like thick pancake batter. I don't worry about it, and it's a very happy, healthy starter. A lot of times in my recipes, I call for fed sourdough starter, and I've had people wonder what that means. So basically, what I mean by that is that it's had flour and water, and it's had an opportunity to sit out and feed on that. If you are going to feed your starter, let's say it's out of the fridge, you want to feed it, give it flour and water and stir it up real good. You don't want to instantly put it back in the fridge, even if you're not planning to use it. You want it to sit out a few hours, let it feed and be active for a little bit, then cover it and put it back in the refrigerator. Now at that point, you could pull it right out of the refrigerator and use it for a pancake, sourdough skillet. It has been fed. So I don't usually like to put my sourdough starter away, not fed. Not saying I haven't done it and it still worked out just fine. So let's say in that morning, Saturday morning, it's pancake time. And I fed it the day before to have pancakes. Ideally, what you want to do is give it some flour and water, let it sit out a few more hours, then put it away as it's been fed. I've totally taken it after pancakes, put it in the fridge, and not fed it again till next week. It's fine. So honestly, there is way less rules to this, and you'll get really familiar with your starter. It'll have a little bit of a different smell if it hasn't been fed in a while. Things will taste a little bit more sour. So if you like to avoid the super sour sourdough taste, you might just feed it more often and not let it sit out as long. But if you are super intolerant to grains, you're going to want to let it sit out at least 24 hours to do all of the fermenting work. If you're just trying to get a little bit of the sourdough taste and a little bit of that fermentation, you can let it ferment for a lot less time, avoid a lot of that sour taste, but it won't have the full benefits of the fermented grains, if that makes sense. All right, now I'm gonna visit a few of my questions on Instagram. Those are some of the most common ones I get. If you get your starter from someone, how long should you wait before using it to bake? I would say just feed it once, let it bubble up, then you can use it. If it's a nice, active starter that person has maintained, you shouldn't have to do any kind of waiting. Sometimes it may take a little bit to adjust to the new environment if it's really far away. Otherwise, I'd say it's good. So if I gave this starter to a friend of mine who lives, you know, somewhere near me maybe, I would expect that they could go straight to using this right away, no problem. It's a nice established starter. I could just give them about a cup of it. They could add a little bit of flour and water to that, give it a good stir, and then within 8 hours, they have a nice active fed starter that they can start maintaining. And it all came from my original 8-year-old starter. Someone asks, how do you start? I have a recipe for that. I'll leave a link below for my blog and my YouTube video. I have all the instructions there. Favorite recipe? I actually have a video plan where I'm gonna share all my favorite recipes. Have you ever tried making it in a Dutch oven? Best bread I've ever made and eaten. I still haven't, can you believe that? I plan to. I actually got a Dutch oven for Christmas, still haven't done it, but I definitely plan to. How would you make gluten-free sourdough starter? And the answer is, I don't know. I know that there are instructions out there online, and I can leave a link in the description below for some of the good articles that I've read. I've never done it and I don't have any experience with it, so I really don't know. To start, you have to split it in half and then feed it. What do you do with one of the halves? You just throw it away. I'm sorry, it's just part of it because you have to use so much flour and water to get it established, and there's not a whole lot you can do with it. If you cannot stand the waste, you could possibly make one of my sourdough skillets. It wouldn't have the exact same effect, but it could definitely still be done that way. It won't be an established starter. Essentially what you have for the first couple of days is just flour and water. Someone wants to know the rough schedule for uses, like I feed it on Monday. Like I said, I don't have any schedule for it. Some weeks I'm just using it left and right. I know whenever I was making my sourdough cinnamon roll recipe, I had to test it several times to get it right. So I ended up using my starter basically daily for that whole week. I just kept feeding it and feeding it and feeding it and using it. And then I might have put it in the fridge for 2 weeks. I don't even know. No schedule, it always seems to be very resilient. Is it normal for it to develop a hard crust over top when it's in the bowl? Yes, whenever you have it sitting out and there's something not airtight on it, that's totally normal. You can either scrape it off or you can just stir it in. Another thing that happens when it hasn't been fed for a while, it gets a little black layer of liquid. That's totally normal. You can either stir it in or pour it off. How did the starter do whenever you moved? We moved from one location to another about an hour apart. And we are in transition for a little while, so my starter was not used for at least 2 weeks. It was sitting in a cooler here, on a truck here. Now, one benefit is that it is winter, and so it never got hot and starving, which it would do if it was super hot. It needs to be fed more often. So it did completely fine. Whenever I started using it again here at the new home, it worked just fine. To feed it, do you take out half and add flour or just add flour? You just add to it. Once it's established, don't worry about anything that you originally did to start it. You just add flour and water, that's it. It's the easiest thing to care for once it's good and established. How do you know if your sourdough starter is good, like it hasn't spoiled or molded? That's kind of an individual basis. People will send me questions like, it smells like this, and honestly, I really don't know. I know that it should not have an off-putting smell. It definitely has a sour smell to it, but it's not off-putting. Now you'll be able to see if there's any mold, and you'll definitely know if it's working if it works in your recipe. So if you're making sourdough bread, you make the dough, you put it in a nice warm spot and it doesn't rise, that means you probably need to continue on making it. It's not fully established yet, or start over. It definitely should make your bread rise if it's good and active. You'll also see a lot of bubbles. So as I sit here, I can see bubbles just rising to the top. And that helps me to know that this is a good active starter. Why is sourdough so much healthier? So this has to do with the grains and the fermentation. So a lot of people these days cannot tolerate grains. For the most part, I think we all kind of know that. A lot of people have given up grains. People are going gluten-free, grain-free. Well, the basics behind this, and I am not a scientist or an expert in this, but this is basically what I know about it. On the outside of a grain, there is a protective layer, and it has something called phytic acid. That phytic acid is very incompatible with your body absorbing and digesting those grains. So whenever you ferment them, it takes care of that pre-digesting work for you, and it makes the grains and the nutrients in them more easily accessible for your body, and your body can recognize it and use it without having to go through those original steps of breaking down the phytic acid, which can be very taxing and difficult for your body. And so fermentation just makes the nutrients more readily available. What was locked up inside that phytic acid in the bran, the outside of the grain, is now available for your body to use. So a lot of those vitamins that are in there aren't actually doing you any good, and this unlocks that. So a lot of times people who can't tolerate grains find that if they let their sourdough ferment for at least 24 hours and they make bread or pancakes or English muffins or whatever that way, they have no trouble dealing with them. So I personally can tolerate grains. I can eat just store-bought bread, I can eat anything and it doesn't really bother me. But if you're a person who's sensitive to grains, now I'm not celiac, I definitely would talk to your doctor before trying this. If you're celiac, you'll never be able to tolerate even sourdough. But if you're just sensitive to grains and you get a little bit of a tummy ache after you eat grains, try this. You might find that you can totally do it. Okay, how warm does a new starter need to be? We keep our house at 65. Is that warm enough? I would recommend keeping it a little bit warmer for a sourdough starter. Now, if it's winter, which it is, you might want to wait until spring or summer to give it a go. They really do like that warm air. Anything below that, they can become inactive and not really establish. I probably wouldn't try until the house was at least 70. Now, I could be wrong on that, but I really think that they need to be more active. Now, I find even myself in the winter here, when our house is on, you know, 68-ish, I can get away with leaving the starter on the counter for couple of days without it getting overly fermented. Whereas in the summer, I find that after 12 hours, if our house is 80 degrees, because we usually keep it on about 80, it's smelling really sour. Same with my other ferments. Water kefir will be out of control fermented after just 12 hours. My milk kefir will be very sour. But in the winter, a lot of times, I find that my water kefir bottles aren't popping and it's just not really taken off. Those cultures are just kind of laying low in the cold weather. It's something that you're gonna get really familiar with by smell, by taste, and it's not so cut and dry as leave it out for this amount of time with this amount of flour and water. It's something that you just have to add to and smell and get familiar with. But trust me, you will after you do it a while. Is it better to start from scratch or buy a starter? I've never actually bought a starter. It's probably something I would consider doing. I would say whenever I first started this, I didn't have as many kids. I only had, I think my daughter was a baby, so I had two. And so it sounded like a really fun project to try. I was probably too cheap to buy one. Now I would maybe attempt it, but I've had such good luck with this starter that, I don't know, I would probably say start one yourself, and then if it doesn't work out, you can always buy one. But it's really a simple process. When starting your starter, did you measure by weight or just use a measuring cup? I totally just used a measuring cup. I never get too particular about instructions, but you all know that. My sourdough starter in the fridge has gray water. It smells good and still has bubbles. Is it bad? Yep, that's that black stuff I was talking about. Totally normal, not bad. Gets it all the time. Just means you need to feed it a little bit more often. That happens usually when it's a little bit hungry. I have no idea how to even start or make sourdough bread. I do have a recipe for that on here. There's also tons of other great recipes all over the internet. I even have, personally, a cinnamon raisin variety as well. So there's lots of recipes to try. I would like more recipes and a fail-proof recipe for bread. Bread just scares me. I will say that sourdough bread can be finicky, and that's why I put the French toast casserole, or some people call it bread pudding, recipe on here, because if you get a sourdough brick, you can still use it. I don't know if there, maybe there is, correct me if I'm wrong, you guys can leave a link. If there is a fail-proof sourdough bread, it's definitely kind of an old art and it takes a lot of practice. How does the bread taste? Does it have a fermented taste to it? It does, it's sour, and so that's something you have to be aware of. It's not gonna taste just like store-bought bread. It is sour because for all of the rising, it was done by souring and all of the grains have been soured. Can you use regular unbleached flour or should it be organic? You totally can. You could even use all-purpose flour. I have, in a pinch, fed my starter with all-purpose flour just because I didn't have my normal wheat that I get. I get it from a co-op and I grind it in my Nutrimill, and that's what I normally use. But there's been times where I have nothing and I just throw in some even bleached all-purpose and it's always been fine. I get overwhelmed thinking about doing this, but so want to start. What's your advice? Just start, and if you fail, you can just try again. It's not super complicated, but if something goes wrong with your starter, try again. You'll get really familiar with the process. I'm sure eventually you'll become really comfortable with your starter. It's like anything you try. At first, you have no idea what you're doing, and then after a while, you get really familiar with it. It becomes just easy. It's such an easy thing to incorporate that you don't even think about it anymore. All right, well, I think that's all the questions I got. I got several repeats of the same question, so I know a lot of you have the same questions. So I hope that this was helpful. If I left something out, leave it in the comments below. We will at least add it to the blog post, and then maybe I'll do another Q&A in the future. But there will be a blog post associated with this, with all of the questions and answers and any additional questions that you all may have, so that you can know how to use your sourdough starter and implement it in your kitchen. While we're on the topic of sourdough and cooking things from scratch in your kitchen, I wanna tell you about something from my friend Jill over at the Prairie Homestead. I don't know if you guys know Jill, but she has three children. She has been homesteading for many, many years. She and her husband work side by side at home with their home business, and she does tons of cooking from scratch. She is definitely an expert in this area and someone that I completely look up to. She has just launched, or is about to launch, a course called the Heritage Cooking Crash Course. If you all are on my email list or my Instagram, you've heard about this. But she is offering a free viewing period from March 11th through March 15th. So I'm gonna leave a link in the description below for you to check out. You can sign up to watch the whole thing completely for free from March 11th through March 15th. She has lessons on how to safely can veggies, broth, meat in a pressure canner, how to cure your own ham and summer sausage, how to do sourdough. She does a lot of sourdough instruction on there. She has bread techniques that yield gorgeous crusty loaves, how to make melt-in-your-mouth mozzarella cheese. Now that's something I have never tried, so I cannot wait to see it whenever the March 11th free viewing period comes. How to do fermented veggies. I've done a little bit of that on this channel, but I cannot wait to see Jill's take on it. Also, there is a bonus section where a bunch of different bloggers shared something from their own kitchen. I did my sourdough cinnamon roll recipe in the bonus section. So make sure to check out the link in the description below so that you can sign up to watch the whole thing for free. Clear your schedule for March 11th through March 15th. And of course, it'll be available for purchase after that if you wanna keep rewatching it and rewatching it and using that as part of your homestead and from scratch kitchen, library, resource. It's gonna be an awesome one. I know that she even brought in a professional video crew to shoot the whole thing. So I can tell you it's gonna be really good. Now, if you're watching this video later on, it's past the free viewing period, make sure to still check out the course because it's actually super affordable. I cannot believe the price that Jill's offering this for. It just has so much good information, especially if you're brand new to fermenting and canning and you just wanna start incorporating some of these, as she calls them, Ma Ingles, kitchen techniques in your own kitchen. I'll leave a link for that in the description below. All right, well, if you're brand new to my channel, please hit that subscribe button. I make 2 new videos every week on food from scratch, natural living, and a handmade home. Thank you so much for stopping by the Farmhouse.